Time now for another edition of the panel brought to you by Sport Chek. Tom Gazzola alongside Bob Stauffer and Jack Michaels from the Oilers Radio Network. Guys, heading into this five-game homestand, we thought St. Louis would be the toughest challenge. Turns out that they beat the Blues, dropped the game to Arizona, dropped the game to Nashville, and maybe a better performance against St. Louis in terms of physical matchup.
Well, and I think St. Louis was still a tough matchup. I mean, the Blues are the number one team in the West going into that game against the Edmonton Oilers, but the Oilers have revamped their roster as compared when they saw them in October. I mean, guys like Zach Cassian and Patrick Maroon and Darnell Nurse was back from a three-game suspension, so that's added some thickness to the Edmonton lineup, and the Oilers, in large portion of that game, outplayed the St. Louis Blues, particularly on special teams. They had better goaltending, and they scored four power play goals. The power play was long overdue, and two other guys who'd been ice cold, Ryan Nugent-Hopkins, who granted missed a ton of time with injury, scored twice. Mark Letestu had his second three-point game in the National Hockey League, and the Oilers bust out in a big way, and they lay six on St. Louis.
You bring up the power play, Jack, and Bob, heading into that game against the Blues had the second-best PK in the league. Oilers hadn't scored, I think it was only four power play goals in their last 20 games, and all of a sudden they break out like that. Is that, you know, a good sign from the special teams?
Well, it's better than if they'd gone 0 for 6. But, take a look at what happened last night, and, you know, sometimes you get a little bit of puck luck. I thought they were sharper, quicker, and more assertive in terms of directing pucks to the net, which they needed to do. I mean, this is obviously still a work in progress, and Jack alluded to the fact that the Oilers added some bulk and some size to their lineup. Peter Chiarelli's not done here in terms of putting this lineup together long term, and I think we can expect a right-handed power play type defenseman in the future joining the club at some point. But in the meantime, anytime you go from 27th to 20th in one night on the power play, it's a pretty good night. So they got to continue to try to build some momentum on that and do that without having the big shot from the point. One of the things that helped last night, Andre Sekera got some pucks through to the net, and that created some opportunities for Edmonton.
Simplicity, and Tom McLellan says they outworked the PK of the Blues. Okay, finally, with the defense core being decimated by injury, there's some opportunity, and guys seem to slowly be taking that opportunity. Is that what we're beginning to see a little bit here?
Well, they're getting the opportunities to play big minutes. I mean, Jordan Oesterle is playing the same kind of minutes he was down in the American Hockey League. He's been in excess of 20 the last couple of games, and he's played well. And he showed that he's learned how to play to his strengths this year. His strengths are speed, agility, and the ability to transition the puck quickly from defense to offense. And as a result, his underwhelming size isn't an issue.
Yeah, and the other thing, Jack, is the game's changed a bit too, right? You got to be able to move. And I think that plays into Osterley's strengths long term. The other thing is he's a different player now than he was a year ago when he was called up. And I like Griffin Reinhart. He had a competitive night last night. He engaged with David Backes a couple times. He needs to do that. He needs to be more of an assertive personality on the ice. But a couple opportunities there for guys to show what they can do to maybe make a little bit of an impact long term with management.
Up and down the roster, this is a time of year where it's a chance to make final impressions with the coaching staff and change how they perceive you, not necessarily at the end of the year, Tom, but going into next year's training camp, and give themselves an opportunity to make the roster out of camp.
Finally, maybe a thought on three legitimate centermen right now that are playing down the middle. How are we liking that so far?
Well, I mean, you know, I do think at some point we may only see two of those. Mark Letestu, you know, was signed here to be a bottom six center. He probably played a little bit too much, around 16 minutes for most of the season, better suited to play 12 or 13. It gives the Oilers a guy that's got offensive ability down the middle, 5-on-5. And Nugent Hopkins just coming back from injury. You know, he's had some good moments, obviously hitting the post in the opening game. And Draisaitl had a star-crossed night against St. Louis. Yep. And Connor McDavid, well, he's Connor McDavid.
This is very similar to the situation that Todd McLellan faced in San Jose at the beginning of Joe Pavelski's career, a way to deal with three strong centermen down the middle. What he ultimately did and what he ultimately found was he wasn't getting Pavelski enough quality minutes, so he moved Pavelski to the wing. And at some point, I think it will happen in the final nine games, at some point, you're going to see Draisaitl back on the wing with Nugent Hopkins in the middle. I think you'll see that combo. But the nice thing is again, when you've got guys who could play center, you've got the flexibility to go three deep at center. If you want to go with three offensively skilled lines, then you can load up the top six and transition into a more defensively oriented bottom six if you need to.
A good problem to have. We'll see how the Oilers manage it carrying forward. Everything gets going against Vancouver Friday night. So homestand wraps up Sunday, then the Oilers hit the road for three, and then we get set to say goodbye to Rexall Place. Jack and Bob have the call for you, as always, on Chad Friday night. I've got you covered right here on EdmontonOilers.com.